الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله. With the commencement of the first day of Ramadan, many people will be performing Salatul Taraweeh in their homes, and a lot of them who are non-huffaz will be reading some of the surahs from the end of Juz Amma. And inshallah, we will try and do a very brief tafsir of the last 10 surahs of Juz Amma to create some understanding in our hearts when we perform our salah, so that it assists us in our concentration and also in picturing what message Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to reveal to us. So inshallah, if Allah ta'ala gives us the tawfiq, we will commence with the last 10 surahs from Suratul Fil all the way down to Suratul Nas. And we ask you to make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the tawfiq to continue with this. Suratul Fil is a very powerful surah. It is a Makki surah and it has 5 verses. It refers to the people of the elephants, which is a famous incident that took place in the year that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. That is, approximately 50 to 55 days before the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in 570 AD in the Gregorian calendar. And it was a very monumental event, which is known as a special prelude to the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we call this irhas, preludes or signs that came before the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also before the birth of many anbiya, to highlight the coming of these great people. And Mufassirin mentioned that this was one of the greatest signs of the birth, of the upcoming birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, the background to the revelation of this verse is that in Yemen, not far from Mecca, was a group of people, Christian people, who were being persecuted by the rulers of Himyar. And they were extremely, extremely in a very difficult circumstances. The rulers at the time, the oppressive rulers, would kill people. And in one instance, it is mentioned that they would kill in cold blood 20,000 practicing Christians into a large fire pit, and all of them were burnt alive. So they sent to the Christian kings for assistance, and the Christian kings then appointed a person by the name of Abraha as the viceroy of the dominion after he went out and he liberated these people, and he was the viceroy on behalf of the Christian Abyssinians. Abraha built a superbly luxurious cathedral in Yemen, and the purpose was to attract the people of Yemen to make pilgrimage to this cathedral instead of the Kaaba in Mecca. It was huge and tall, so that a person standing at the bottom was unable to see the top, and he decorated the structure with gold, silver, and other precious gems. And he wished that this architectural masterpiece, which was second to none in his opinion, would be revered by all and sundry, and it would divert the pilgrims from the Kaaba in Makkatul Mukarrama to this cathedral that he had built in Yemen. And he did this after he had witnessed the love and enthusiasm of the Yemeni Arabs, which were the same as those felt all over Arabia for the honored Kaaba. What had happened at that time, there's the Arabs, although they were idol worshippers, they had a lot of love and reverence for the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and particularly the Kaaba, and this had permeated into their hearts. As a result, the tribes of Mecca, including the Quraysh, were enraged and infuriated by this proclamation by Abraha. And one night, somebody from one of these tribes entered the church and defecated in it. And when Abraha came to know about it and learned that a Qurayshi had done this, he then swore to march to the house of Mecca, the Kaaba, and to destroy it stone by stone. Now, the king of Abyssinia at the time had sanctioned this particular expedition and sent a contingent of elephants to assist. And the idea was that the elephants would be used to demolish the Kaaba stone by stone. And they planned to do this by fastening the chains to the pillars of the Kaaba and placing the other ends around the neck of the elephant. And they would then make the elephant pull on them in order to tear down the walls of the Kaaba. May Allah Ta'ala protect us from something like this. So when they set out, they moved through the Arabian Peninsula. Some Arab tribes tried to raise an army against them, but were defeated. And eventually they ended up coming close to Mecca, and they sent for the leader of the Quraysh at the time, and Abdul Muttalib, who was the grandfather of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, began interacting with Abraha. And Abraha, when he saw him, he was highly impressed, because Abdul Muttalib had the most handsome, charming, and attractive personality. And he, when he met with Abraha, Abraha actually descended from his throne and sat on the carpet on the ground. And it so happened that as part of the skirmish, Abraha had taken about 200 camels of Abdul Muttalib, and Abdul Muttalib went and asked him to return his camels to him. And a short summary of this interaction is that Abraha was amazed, thinking that this noble personality comes and he's not even talking about the Kaaba, but he's only interested in these camels. And Abdul Muttalib replied to him that the camels, I am responsible for them, but when it comes to the Kaaba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is responsible for that, and he will protect it if he so wishes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then sent this army of birds, and the birds started coming through from around the area of the sea, and people began seeing these birds, which had never been seen before, coming, and they then carried with them approximately 3 pebbles the size of gram seeds or lentils, and they then destroyed the army of Abraha. Some important points here is that one of the elephants was known as Mahmud. It was the largest elephant that was sent, the strongest elephant. And as they were on the morning of entering into Makkatul Mukarrama, the guide, who happened to be an Arab, whispered into the ear of this elephant and said to him that, you know, this is the sacred house of Allah, and you should not enter into it. And the elephant then refused to enter into the direction of Mecca, no matter how much they prodded it, they attacked it, they put arrows into its trunk, but it refused to move. It would walk towards the opposite directions very fast, but when it was asked to walk in the direction of Mecca, it refused, and it kneeled and did not move forward. So these birds came through. The birds were smaller than pigeons. They had red claws, and they had 3 pebbles the size of lentils or gram seeds that they had with them. And when they dropped these pebbles, it would go through the people and onto the ground. And through a very painful way, people then began to die. Most of the elephants, barring one, left Mecca and were not harmed, but the army were killed in this manner. In fact, Abraha himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not allow him to die immediately, but afflicted him with a deadly disease as a result of the pebbles from the birds, and a kind of poison spread through his entire body, causing every single part to decay, and his limbs began to rot and separate from the rest of his body, and he started losing one finger after the other, and eventually this is how he died. Another interesting thing to note here was that 2 of the drivers of the elephant, 2 people who were the drivers of the elephant Mahmud, they were also afflicted, and they then became blind and paralyzed, and they lived later on, and Aisha radiallahu anha and Asma radiallahu anha both mentioned that in their lifetimes they saw these blind people who were paralyzed begging in the streets of Mecca, and this was the effect of this particular incident that had taken place. So we now move into the translation itself. The very first verse, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asking him, have you not seen how your Lord dealt with the people of the elephant? أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. Have you not seen how your Lord has dealt with the people of the elephant. Now, interestingly here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring directly to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was not born during the time of this event. We mentioned earlier that it occurred approximately 50 to 55 days before his birth. So how is it possible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking him about whether he had seen it? Mufassirin mentioned that here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting the certainty of this event, that the effects of the event had been seen afterwards in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Amongst them, the witnessing of the blind and the paralyzed men, and the witnessing the knowing of the people that were there at that time who had narrated this event, it happened with certainty. Then the next verse, أَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ كَيْدَهُمْ فِي تَضْلِيلِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, has He not turned their plan into misguidance? Has He not turned their plan into misguidance? وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلِ. And He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sent upon them flying birds in flocks. وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ. And He sent upon them flying birds in flocks. Now this word ababil, it is a plural, but it has no singular, and it refers to flocks of flying birds. It is mentioned that these were smaller than pigeons, and they had red claws, and the type of bird was such that it had not seen before. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent armies of birds that surrounded them, and they were continuous flocks that surrounded this army all around in every direction. تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّن سِجِّيلٍ. Throwing upon them stones of baked clay. تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّن سِجِّيلٍ. Throwing upon them stones of baked clay. This word سِجِّيل is an Arabicized Persian word which comes from two words called سَنْ, which is stone, and جِل or جِل, which is clay. And it is common clay that is rolled into little balls and baked to harden. So these little stones of baked clay were not generally heavy or hard like pieces of rock that are chipped from mountains. And this highlights the power and the qudra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who uses this insignificant, harmless piece of clay, but when sent with His power, it is deadly, and it killed the entire army of Abraham. فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this army and what happened to them, and thus He turned them into eaten chaff. فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. And thus He turned them into eaten chaff. This word asf, it refers to chaff, dust or straw, comes from the verb as well, asafa ya'asifu, which means that it is thrown around by the wind. So it's something totally insignificant. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting the fact that this was the ultimate outcome for Abraha and his army. So in conclusion, this particular event, event of the army of elephants, this enhanced the love of Quraysh in the entire Arabian Peninsula, because they now began to see that the Quraysh were the men of Allah, and they were custodians of the sacred house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as a result, this allowed them to travel freely for trade without fear of attacks, etc. Because the rest of the Arabian Peninsula recognized that these were special people who were under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This event also honored the Kaaba in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it highlighted the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using something so small and insignificant to defend against His enemies. And we can look at it today that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought the entire world to a standstill with something that's even smaller than these birds, and something that's even smaller than these pebbles, a virus that can only be seen with the microscope. But with the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the entire world has been turned on its heels. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the correct understanding. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.